Welcome to the Workology Podcast, a podcast for the disruptive workplace leader. Join host Jessica Miller-Merrill, founder of Workology.com, as she sits down and gets to the bottom of trends, tools, and case studies for the business leader, HR, and recruiting professional who is tired of the status quo. Now here's Jessica with this episode of Workology.
Experts estimate that the virtual reality and augmented reality market will be worth $120 billion by 2022. Earlier this year, we had technology expert Robert Scoble on the Workology podcast. He talked to us about how virtual reality could be used to change workplace collaboration and training. But what about recruiting? Universities like Princeton are already using virtual reality as part of their campus recruiting process. And I was thrilled when during my trip to Austin, Texas for the South by Southwest conference, I stumbled onto Gap, and their virtual reality experience is part of the conference's job fair. You might have guessed that today we are talking about virtual reality, or VR as it is often called, and how it can be used in recruiting. Today I'm excited to be joined by Nick Boyd. He's the head of talent attraction and supply at Gap. Nick, welcome to the Workology podcast.
Thank you so much for having me.
Can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you came to work in recruiting and HR?
Absolutely. So my career is a little bit unique, and I didn't sort of set out to get into the world of recruiting. So by training, I am actually a marketer. So I spent the first 8 years of my career in marketing. So I really sort of grew up from a professional sense at Target, started as an intern, and then over the course of several years, had the opportunity to work on several businesses and different initiatives, and love sort of the art and the science of marketing. And so while I was at Target, the talent acquisition team tapped me with a really interesting proposition. So at the time, they were really looking to reinvent their digital and social strategy. And that was something that I was particularly interested in. But also, they were at an interesting inflection point where they were really looking to take their employer brand global. And so as a marketer, these are things and projects that you definitely want to touch and feel and be a part of. And so I moved over to the world of recruiting, and I stayed there for 2 years working on really incredible projects. And for me, I just fell in love with the space. And so what really seemed to resonate for me was it was marketing with a purpose. And I loved the heart and the soul of connecting people to meaningful opportunities through storytelling. And so having done that job for 2 years, growing up in Minneapolis my whole life, I knew I wanted to experience something outside of that. And so when Gap came to me with the opportunity to build their first ever global talent brand function, it was an opportunity that I couldn't pass up. And so that's what I've been doing over the last 3 years. So my role started very focused on talent branding, but over the 3 years, I've picked up a number of other functions, everything from recruiting advertising to enterprise recruiting events, recruiting operations, and all of that really good stuff. But I've loved every minute of it.
I love your background. And I always find it so interesting how many people have crossed over from marketing into human resources.
Yeah.
There's a lot of similarities to trying to reach out to candidates and the tools and the technologies that we use. For example, programmatic advertising. I've had a couple conversations with folks as of late, and it's becoming more and more popular in our space too.
Absolutely. And recruiting is marketing, right? I think we're kidding ourselves if we think about it differently. And so it's been really inspiring for me to help educate my peers in the recruiting space around marketing strategies and tactics and processes that lend themselves so nicely to recruiting. So it's been really fun.
Well, I love your point of view, and I want to get to the fun stuff that we're going to talk about today, which is virtual reality. Can you give me a primer, and for maybe those who haven't tried out virtual reality before, how does it work and what does it do?
Yeah, absolutely. I can try my best. It's absolutely one of those things it's easier to experience it than it is to explain it. But the way that I often describe it is it really is a 360 immersive digital experience. And so the type of virtual reality that we've gone after from a Gap Inc. recruiting perspective has really been around video. And so for us, we've really been thinking about how do we allow candidates, when they're not physically with us, to experience what it's like to walk the halls of our buildings in San Francisco or New York? And so virtual reality is really our opportunity for them to put on the headset and really be transported into the world that is Gap Inc. And so we've taken it to conferences, and people have been able to experience San Francisco and New York and our campuses without physically having to be there.
How is Gap using virtual reality in recruiting, and what type of results and reactions are you seeing?
Yeah, so for us, it's really important that we are thinking about immersive experiences. And so one of the things that we battle is, you know, people have a legacy perception of some of our brands. And so depending on the last time they went into one of our stores, they might have the wrong impression of who we are. The other thing that we have to battle is when people hear our brand names like Old Navy or Gap or Banana Republic, they often think about the store. And so people have a hard time envisioning what would it be like to work at corporate. And so one of the things that we wanted to do with virtual reality is really create this immersive experience where people can actually see themselves, you know, walking the halls of Gap and getting a sense of what the environment is like. And so essentially we created a virtual tour of our offices in San Francisco and New York. And so it's a really great way for candidates to be able to tour our buildings nationally without physically having to travel between locations.
Was South by Southwest the first time that you had used virtual reality?
Yeah, so for us, showing up at South by Southwest for the first time, we knew that we had to go big and do it in the right way. And when you think of just the level of creative talent and digital and tech talent that was there, we knew that we needed to stand out. And we felt like virtual reality would be a great way to do that. And so for us, the reaction has been pretty incredible. So if you've never watched someone do virtual reality, you get a ton of joy just by watching someone else and the facial reactions and you know, how they react to what they're seeing. It's pretty incredible. But for us, there was sort of this element of being able to provide a first-time experience for a lot of people. A lot of people just haven't done virtual reality. And so for us to give them their first dose, it was fun to hear people say, like, wow, I didn't even know that was possible. And then to then, you know, add the fact that I didn't know that your buildings looked like that, or I didn't know that, you know, you had all of these brands. For us, it really has been incredible. And it automatically, for us, really inspires a conversation around, oh, well, tell me more. And I'd love to know more about, you know, this particular job or that particular building. So it's been a great conversation starter and conversion into actual applications.
Wonderful. Well, and, you know, that's what I think as a recruiting leader, that you want to see qualified candidates heading your direction because they've had a really great experience, virtual reality or not, but in your case, VR related. Are you planning on expanding this beyond South by Southwest? If so, where do you maybe see other conferences or career fairs, things like that?
Yeah, absolutely. So South by Southwest was version 1.0. We're in the process now of creating a different edit for an event that we're attending in June. So this will be our second year attending Graduate Fashion Week in London, where our audience is a little bit different. So it's emerging fashion designers. And so we're reshooting video that's really tailored around our design spaces and really showcasing the creativity within our offices. And it'll be a really great sort of 2.0 version that's really geared towards designers. So as we're thinking about virtual reality, it really is about segmentation in the different conferences or events that we attend. And we always want to make sure that the content that we're delivering is hyper-relevant. And so that's how, you know, in the short term, we're planning to use virtual reality. But I would say that we are just scratching the tip of the iceberg in terms of the possibilities of what the technology could enable.
Well, that is a good segue to my next question. In terms of other ways to use VR, either in recruiting, marketing, or business. And I want to give you an example because I thought this was really amazing and it might be something that you can take back. But Lowe's has been using VR for training new managers to save on travel and hotel expenses. And so basically they're putting them into a virtual environment where they can tour their distribution centers, look at other stores as far as formats and layouts. Or do you have any brainstorms or ideas of maybe different areas?
Yeah, so I would absolutely say that learning and development and training, it feels like a no-brainer. The other thing that I think about is I think it could be great for connecting global teams. One of the things that we noticed is even as we started to show the virtual reality experience internally, some of our team members hadn't been to the other locations. And so it was an opportunity for them to see what those other buildings were like. And the cultures are a little bit different. So I do think that there's huge potential in just connecting global teams. I could see it playing nicely into things like fitness classes and health and wellness. And so when we think about our active business across, you know, Gap Fit, Old Navy, Athleta, there could be some really cool things that we can do there to not only showcase, you know, living in a healthy, active lifestyle, but then with the backdrop of our brands and our product could be really cool. And then I don't, you know, think that, you know, virtual reality video interviewing would be too far off in the future. So again, there's so many places that this could go, and I'm excited to experiment and iterate and try new things along the way.
I can't wait to see what is in store for this area, particularly in recruiting and human resources. I think the possibilities are endless. Really, it just comes down to money and then adoption by different parties.
Absolutely.
Well, let's take a bit of a reset here. This is Jessica Miller-Merrill, and you're listening to the Workology Podcast. Today, we're talking about using virtual reality. Yes, you heard correctly. Virtual reality and recruiting and talent attraction. I'm here with Nick Boyd. He's from The Gap, and you can connect with Nick on Twitter, and it's Nicholas A. Boyd. NICHOLASBOYD. Awesome. Connect with Nick. Give him a tweet and then also give you his LinkedIn at the end of the transcript over on the Workology site. One of the challenges with virtual reality is that the technology isn't necessarily accessible for people who fall under the Americans with Disabilities Act. Have you guys thought about this? It's not something I think is been talked about a lot, but one of our writers on our site had talked about the ADA and how people who are seeing impaired or blind, they won't be able to experience the work environment the same way.
Yeah, really good question. So we are certainly not alone in facing this challenge. I think anyone that's using virtual reality right now, we haven't quite cracked the code on what that looks like, but it is something that that is on our radar, and we look forward to learning more and trying to figure it out. But you know, for us, it's really important that we don't put all of our sort of experience or, you know, content eggs in one basket. And so in order to reach diverse audiences, we also need to present that content in a variety of different ways. So we're doing that in everything from video to you know, storytelling and content to podcasts. So for us, that's how we are currently able to reach a diverse audience. But as far as virtual reality goes, there's still a lot of work to be done in order to make sure that we are able to deliver the experience to a diverse audience.
I think this is just an important point to make, because I think a lot of people kind of get hung up sometimes on, oh, is it ADA compliant? And it's my understanding that as long as you're offering, as you said, a diverse cross-section of different tools for maybe in written form, audio form, all these different, for lack of word, pieces of media, you're going to be fine under the Americans with Disabilities Act.
Yep. That's been our approach for sure.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like you guys cover a lot of different bases, and you're telling stories in many different ways, which I think is really creative. Well, what are some other fun or cool things that you guys have up your sleeve over there that you can share?
Well, I don't want to reveal too much, but some of the things that are top of mind for us, some of which we're a little bit further along than others, but we're really thinking about talent rediscovery. So we have thousands and thousands of people that apply to us every year. And so how can we go back and rediscover some of that talent? We're looking into artificial intelligence and automation, machine learning. I think there's a lot that we can do there, and we want to be at the forefront of figuring out what that means from a recruiting perspective. And then one of the things that I can share that we just launched is a new careers blog. So it's sort of BuzzFeed meets Muse, and houses exclusive content from Gap Inc. and our brands, all in the career space. So it's something that we're really, really excited about. It allows us to really not only tell our story and the stories of our employees, but you get to hear it from their voices. So we're reaching out across our organization and really encouraging people to tell their stories. And so I would encourage anyone who's interested to check out our new blog. It's careersblog.gapinc.com. And just take a look at some of the stuff that we'll be promoting to really showcase our culture, to help people understand what it's like to work here, and also set them up for interview success.
I love that you're preparing them and providing them with resources and information and giving them insights into their culture through many different channels. And I am definitely a fan of blogging, so I can't wait to see. I love BuzzFeed meets the Muse. I think that will be a lot of fun.
We're really, really excited.
So one of the things I wanted to ask you and maybe kind of explain in a little bit more detail is that at the job fair, I asked you for your business card. And instead, which I thought this was cool, you had me send you a short text to a code or a 5-digit number to get your contact information. Can you kind of walk us through why you do that and then how's it working for you?
Yeah, so as we were preparing for South by Southwest, one of our recruiters said, "Oh, I need to go order more business cards." And I just point out, asked, "Are people still using business cards?" And so it actually led to a really interesting discussion around should we be doing business cards, or is there something more digitally friendly and innovative that we could be doing? And so we ended up creating a text messaging campaign that to, basically your explanation, allowed people that we were connecting with at the conference to text a short code to automatically get our contact information. So it included things like our phone number, our email address, the link to our LinkedIn profile. And it was just a really quick, easy way for candidates to get the information that they needed to stay connected with us. So it was the first time that we tried anything like that, and I will tell you that people loved it. So not only did candidates love it, but our recruiters, now they want it for every day. And so we're figuring out how do we make it more of an evergreen part of our process, and have digital business cards going forward.
Well, I loved it, and I'm going to try this out because I'm at a conference coming up, several conferences. And so it's with your existing text message provider, if you have one, I'm assuming, and then you could just create the secret code, which would be your name in this case, and then you already have the automated message teed up. So when somebody texts Nick to the short code number, they'll get all your information, LinkedIn, Twitter, email, whatever, you're in control of what you share, but you're just limited to the character amount, which 160 characters, I think.
Yep, absolutely. And so, I mean, what's amazing about it is you see super, super high conversion because people can take action right on the spot and they're not having to type in the URL. They can do it just through a matter of clicks.
And they don't lose your contact information. That was what was so genius for me is I just went back to my text messages and then I could follow up with you later on instead of hunting through all the pockets and purses that I have to find your business card.
Absolutely.
Well, switching gears for a second, Gap is a well-recognized brand, but there's other layers of the organization. You talked a little bit about them earlier. How are you collaborating with the different brands when it comes to recruiting and hiring?
Yeah, so really great question. So my job is actually centered around the collaboration across the enterprise. And so really bringing the brands together. So, you know, for us, our competitive advantage is our brand portfolio. And so it's my job to really figure out how do we harness that in our recruiting process, program, story to really drive a competitive advantage for each of our brands. So there are places where we have said it absolutely makes sense for us to play together and we will win together by leveraging our size and our scale. So things like enterprise recruiting events. I think South by Southwest is a really great example of where we showed up together. And in a lot of cases, people don't always know that we have all of these brands our portfolio. And what it means from a recruiting perspective is it means that you can have a really, really rich, fulfilling career by being able to bounce around from function to function, from brand to brand. And then obviously we're a global portfolio. And so that creates a lot of opportunities. And so for us, we're really trying to find those ways to tell that story. Another really great good place where we are, saying it's we want to be really intentional about playing and showing up together is in recruiting advertising and process. There are certain things that just make sense to do together. But on the flip side, there are also places where we've said, you know what, because the consumer first has a relationship or an interaction with the brand, they still need to have their own talent brands. And so we work in a very complex ecosystem in which we have this Gap Inc. talent brand that is inclusive of all brands, but each brand also has their own talent branding efforts. And so we're often thinking about leverage and amplification so that collectively we're really able to increase our share of voice in the marketplace and tell a story that better resonates with our candidates.
I love this because I think a lot of people are struggling with this or thinking about this topic because they're a large company. They have different, maybe well-recognized brands or maybe not so much. So how do you create this overarching brand for you guys, Gap Inc.? And then you have these pockets of smaller brands that are under the umbrella that each are also unique in their identities. And as a consumer, we've all had different experiences, or as employees or former employees, we identify with each one differently. So
yeah,
I think that it's extremely challenging, but says a lot to Gap Inc. and your guys' commitment to employment branding and talent marketing.
Yeah, for us, we want to ensure that all of our brands are in the candidate's consideration set before we lose them to a competitor. And that really is the role that the Gap Inc. talent brand plays. And it doesn't mitigate the individual work that the brands need to do to tell their own story and have candidates resonate and connect with what they're doing. But I will tell you, it's complex. It takes a lot of effort and diligence. And I wouldn't say that we've mastered it, but we've certainly made traction, and we're seeing that in our results.
Well, thank you, Nick, for joining us today. I really appreciate it. It's been so much fun and such good information. Where can people go to learn more about you and what you do?
You can follow me on Twitter. So Nicholas A. Boyd is the handle, or connect with me on LinkedIn. I'm happy to share our story, connect and learn with other people that are facing similar challenges. So don't be shy about reaching out.
I am a firm believer that creativity wins in recruiting. Offering something different or unusual can give you a huge competitive advantage in this competitive talent market. I really love what Gap is doing, and I look forward to seeing how creative strategies like theirs will be used in recruiting as well as VR, whether it's HR, the workplace, or recruitment. I hope that this interview with Nick inspired you to think a little bit out of the box when it comes to HR and recruiting. I know it did for me. Thank you for joining the Workology Podcast, a podcast for the disruptive workplace leader who's tired of the status quo. And virtual reality is definitely not the status quo. This is Jessica Miller-Merrill. Until next time, you can visit workology.com to listen to all our previous Workology Podcast episodes. Have a great day.